I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I'm focusing on preparation of the heart to be faithful till the end. Hello, everyone. In this session, I'm going to talk about the most important step we can take to prepare to stand in difficult times. Certainly, it's what best prepared me for the pressures I faced, and I know it will do the same for you. And this is the pursuit of God's heart. In 2007, I began to pray in a different way. I call it the wave starter prayer. I prayed, "Father God, draw me so close to your heart that you'll be able to trust me with the authority to start waves." So I wanted to see waves of the Holy Spirit, kingdom waves, start in Turkey, which is the largest unevangelized country in the world. But I prayed better than I knew. God put those words in my mouth because he wanted to focus me on the first part of that prayer, "Draw me so close to your heart." And so we began a pursuit of God's heart. We started to pursue intimacy, to go after God's presence. When we talk about loving God, it can be very abstract. So here's how I started in a very practical way. I said, "God, I don't love you with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, but I want to. I want more of you." And the psalmist says, "As a deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you." God, my heart doesn't long for you as a deer longs for streams of water. Make me thirsty for you. And as we asked again and again, we became hungry for God. We started to long for his presence. And this pursuit of God's heart began to change us. And it positioned us to receive assignments from God, including the prison assignment. I don't believe that God put me into prison. Satan did. But I see it as an assignment, because I now understand that God fully intended to use my imprisonment for his purposes. When God allowed me to be thrown in prison, he knew that I was going to break. He knew I would go right up to the point of failure. He knew how difficult it was going to be for me and how much I would struggle. But he did it anyway. Why? I think that he knew he could trust me. I didn't think I could be trusted with this. I was sure that I would fail. But God knew that at my lowest points, I would turn my eyes toward him and not away because of my pursuit of his heart over the years. Here's an important truth I want to underline. Love fuels endurance and perseverance. Love is what makes us willing to undertake risk and hardship, to carry burdens. A lover is willing to endure much for his beloved. We know that fathers and mothers have sacrificed themselves for their children, husbands for their wives. In my case, Noreen remained in Turkey throughout my imprisonment. Leaders we respect urged her to return to the States. "Noreen, let God take care of Andrew. You need to get out of there." But she stayed because she was the only person who could visit me and she knew how desperate I was. She placed herself at personal risk because she loves me. So yes, a lover is willing to suffer for the one he loves. An admirer may not be so willing. God has many admirers, even many servants, but few lovers. Determine that you will be a lover of God, that you will run after his heart. I want to give some examples of how my love for God fueled faithfulness in prison. One day, a verse in Philippians drove into my heart. Paul wrote, "Everyone looks out for their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ." And I began to weep. I thought, this is me in this verse. I realized I had been focused on myself and not what mattered to Jesus. All I wanted was to be with my wife and children. But what if Jesus' interests were best served by my remaining in prison? This became a turning point for me. And I began to fight to get to the point where I could embrace serving the interests of Jesus, even if it meant remaining in prison. This was because of my love for Him. For many months, I had a very difficult time worshiping God. My heart was wounded toward Him. I was struggling with doubt and questioning His character. And I tried to sing, "Great is Your Faithfulness," but I couldn't do it. I would start sobbing. I wasn't seeing His faithfulness. But in my second year, I determined to worship, and I sang to Jesus. And this worship was precious to God because it was a declaration of my love for Him in very difficult circumstances, in the dark night of my soul. I've mentioned the discipline of dancing before God as an act of joy, a joy I didn't feel. And this was actually an act of obedience to Jesus' command to rejoice when we're persecuted. But it was also very much an act of love. I knew that Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." And I loved Him. Therefore, I tried to obey Him. How many times I said, "I just want to be a good son to my Heavenly Father," and then push towards surrender one more time, force myself to look heavenward again, chose to forgive those who were hurting me and my family. Love drove me to do this. In fact, love is what motivated all of these acts. Love is also what helped me to overcome my offended heart, which I talked about in the last session. As I said, for years, I had pursued God's presence. It's because I valued His presence so much that I was so deeply wounded when I lost all sense of it. What I most wanted from God was presence. But there was something that God really wanted from me. Simple devotion. Simple love. A faithful love. He wanted to see if I would devote myself to Him in spite of my questions, my doubts, my disappointment, in spite of His silence. So He stripped everything away, the encouragement of my closest friends, fellowship with other believers, every way in which I had experienced His love in the past. And what was left was a core of love in my heart, a simple devotion that I clung to in desperation. And it was this simple devotion that overcame my offense. Simple devotion said, "I don't need answers. I am focused on loving You. It's enough to love You." Love includes emotions, but it isn't limited to emotions. Love expresses itself in loyalty, in obedience, in commitment, in surrender. And sometimes this is without emotion. It's much easier to feel good about God, to have those emotions of love, when I'm aware of His presence, when I'm experiencing His goodness and His love. But when these are removed, especially under pressure, then our love is tested. A gift, a result of my testing, is that God showed me my heart. After 18 months in prison, the Turkish government finally decided to put me on trial. And a day before it started, I was suddenly moved to my old prison again, where the trial would take place. This was very, very difficult for me. I had experienced a lot of trauma at Shakran prison, so when they returned me there, this triggered all the trauma again. I was put into a solitary cell. Next to me were the generals accused of leading a coup attempt. On my trial day, I was exhausted. I hadn't slept for 2 days. I hadn't eaten. I wasn't given the anti-anxiety medication my body had become dependent on, and I was in court for a 13-hour session. Add to this a terrible stress as I was falsely accused of terror crimes and spying, and I knew this was a completely political case, and the judges didn't care about truth. The prosecutor was asking for a 35-year sentence. And I was told I would be kept in solitary confinement in this traumatic prison for the duration of my trial. And I knew it could go on for years. I was devastated. I lay on the bed, alone, isolated, with great fear and terrible grief welling up inside me, just weeping. And the thought, the prayer kept going through my mind, "Where are You, God? Why have you permitted them to return me to this awful place? Why have you not intervened for me? Why are you so far away, so silent? And I opened my mouth. I was weeping aloud, and I was surprised by what I heard. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. And I realized, wait, here's my victory. Yes, I do love you. Even if you're silent, I love you. Even if you allow my enemy to hurt me, I love you. Even if you do not give me your presence, I love you. I still love you. I had passed the test of silence, the test of solitude, of abandonment, of being alone with no support, the test of unfelt grace, of weakness, of brokenness, the test of doubts, the test of offense. There's a difference between a soldier who has gone through training and acquired skills and a soldier who has the same training, the same skills, but has been in combat. There's a difference. My love for God before I went to prison was sincere and completely genuine. But until it was tested, it was unproven. Now I have proven my love for God. Oh, I know I was weak and broken. I know that grace took me through. But during my worst time, I cried out, I love you, Jesus. Now, God may have known that I would remain faithful, that I would love him. But until I actually went through the test, I hadn't proven this. So my testing and my victory is precious to God, and it's precious to me. I discovered that there's an intimacy that only comes with testing. Some of the people I most admire in the Bible, Abraham, Joseph, Moses, David, and there are others, they went through times of testing during which they experienced the silence of God. But they were faithful, and they emerged as friends of God. Maybe this is what actually qualified them to enter into deeper friendship. The question is, can God trust you? If God doesn't give you what you expect, if he doesn't give you what you think you need, leaves you in silence, will you devote yourself to him anyway? I emphasize this because Jesus said that the most important thing we can do is devote ourselves to God, to love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. It's so clear and simple, and yet it's very difficult to do. And this is because we don't naturally increase in love for God. In fact, our tendency is to decrease, to cool down in love for God. We have to nurture love for God. It doesn't happen on its own. You know, there's only one thing I miss from prison. I never want to go back. I hope I'm never in prison again. But there is something I miss. The conditions of my imprisonment, the isolation, the terrible loneliness, the fear, the uncertainty, they tested me. But they also drove me to cling to God as I never had before. I had an unusual clarity about what matters most and spent my days from morning to night seeking God. I said, I want to keep my eyes on you, Jesus, just like the sunflower that follows the sun throughout the day. I had never been so focused on God. But now that I'm free, and I'm so glad to be free, I don't have those pressures driving me anymore. I don't want the pressures, but I miss the desperation with which I ran after God. The point is that we have to be very intentional about loving God. It's a pursuit, a lifelong pursuit. Begin building this into your life now. Don't wait for hardship to push you to seek God. One of the best ways to do this is to spend time with God. Noreen and I were detained together for 2 weeks. I noticed that she was handling it better than I was. Over the years, we had been like the tortoise and the hare. I would get excited about God, sprint ahead, and then become complacent, whereas Noreen was steady and consistent, making it a priority to spend time with God on a regular basis. Over time, this built a deep reservoir in her. And this is what she was drawing on during that terrible time. There's no substitute for spending time with God. As she looks back, she says, "I was not prepared, but I was not unprepared either." This applies to us. We may not be completely prepared for everything, but we don't have to be unprepared either. Pursue the heart of God. If you make this your priority, everything else in your life will come into right alignment. I'm not saying your life will be easy, but everything will be rightly aligned. We want to emerge from the wilderness, leaning on our beloved, tested and proven worthy of him. I hope you'll join me in the next session, where I'll talk about what I think is the most difficult step in preparing to stand, but it's one we cannot neglect.